Hey, it's time to talk about the best and worst exotic fruits out there. So fruit in season, in moderation, is a good idea. That's how we were designed to take advantage of it. But fruit out of season is part of what drives this. And of course, using high fructose corn syrup in so many of our foods also drives this as well. So is there a smart way to eat fruit? So all fruit is not bad. The key is timing and type. Now, if we eat fruit the way nature intended, seasonally, in moderation, and it's in most natural form, we can actually support our health. Remember, the vibrant colors of fruit were there for a major reason, and that is fruit predators, and I got news for you, you and I are fruit predators, are looking for the maximum sugar content of that food we're eating. Plants, on the other hand, want you to eat their fruit, because it contains their babies that are impossible for us to digest. And you will eat the fruit, take the baby in the form of seeds, and you will walk away and poop it someplace else with a generous dollop of fertilizer. Perfect. So plants use the color of fruit to actually tell you and me when that fruit has its highest sugar content. And it's also, you didn't know, telling you that that seed is now impervious to digestion. You have color vision because you are a fruit predator. And only animals that predate fruit or flowers have color vision. Your dog doesn't have color vision because he doesn't care what color a squirrel is. If it's moving, he wants to eat it. On the other hand, you want the signal from the plant about when it's ripe. I get a kick out of my garden. I have fig trees, and lo and behold, the birds are usually 1 or 2 days ahead of me in figuring out when the fig is at its ripest. So that's why we have color vision. And those intense colors are actually the polyphenols that are of huge benefit to us. So there's nothing wrong with fruit in season, but season is the key word. Now, exotic fruits are hitting the marketplace, and they are becoming commonplace. So what are the best exotic fruits in season? Well, first of all, papaya. Papaya does have a lot of sugar content, and I prefer you eating papayas when they're unripe or early in the ripening process, before they get the maximum sugar content. The less ripe the papaya, the far more fiber, soluble fiber for your gut buddies. One of my personal favorites is passion fruit. I actually grow it in my own yard. Now, that jelly-like substance is packed with polyphenols and soluble fiber, and it's incredibly low in fructose. In places like Italy and France, it is considered a gourmet seasonal delicacy, and it appears on, whenever it's around, it appears on menus. Dragon fruit. Now, dragon fruit is low in sugar, it's high in antioxidants, it's high in polyphenols, and it's a great source of prebiotic fiber. Its flashy color isn't just for show. That's a potent sign of polyphenols. And let me be clear about this, because I get this all the time. People say that I tell you to avoid seeds. And that's absolutely not true. Plants that bear fruits in general want to induce you to eat their fruit and their seeds so that you will take them away and deposit them elsewhere. The plant really doesn't want to drop its seeds directly below the fruit tree because it would be shaded and it would compete for resources from the mother plant. They want you, the predator, to go over there. On the other hand, grasses and other annual plants have found a great place to grow, and they're going to die off every year. So they want their seeds to drop directly below because they've already found a great place. And the last thing they want you to do is take those seeds away. So they don't have a fruit to attract you, but they know that you'll probably eat them anyhow. So they protect those seeds with these anti-nutrient compounds some of which are lectins, some of which are oxalates, and there's other compounds, to try to convince you that this is a bad idea to eat their seeds. Now, it is interesting, immature fruit does have lectins to convince you that now is not the time to eat their babies, because their babies are not protected. And when I was growing up, we ate green apples, when apples were actually green before they were mature. And every kid can tell you that we suffered the green apple two-step. We got some pretty impressive cramps and diarrhea. Yeah, we still did it anyway. But that was the plant defense system against being eaten before its babies were ready. Pretty clever plants. So no, seeds are not the issue. It's how you acquire them. How about cacao? Cacao, chocolate is a fruit, but only if you eat it like one. So raw or fermented cacao, not Dutch processed cocoa powder and candy bars, is rich in polyphenols and brain-supporting compounds. Now, I add it to my coffee every morning. Loquat. I have a couple of loquat trees in my yard. It's originally from China. These are very fiber-rich fruits that really help satiety. They're becoming more common at farmers markets, especially here in California. And if you see them, try them. They actually are very tasty. Asahi. Now, sometimes you see it whole, mostly you see it frozen. The berry itself is a powerhouse of anthocyanins and other polyphenols. But please skip the asahi bowls. They're usually sugar bombs disguised as a health food. Mangosteens, particularly in Northern California, farmers markets are full of mangosteens in season. And mangosteen polyphenols are really great for you. Starfruit, we're beginning to see those. You can eat them sliced whole. You can eat the skin. And of course, there's breadfruit. Now, breadfruit has been a staple for particularly South American cultures. And breadfruit is another great source of fiber, prebiotic fiber. Well, how about exotic fruits to avoid? Unfortunately, a ripe mango is one of the highest sugar-containing foods there is. That's why we love them so much. And I see some of my patients go on mango kicks, and I can see it in their blood work. Their triglycerides go up. Their insulin resistance goes up. They become pre-diabetic because they've got a mango tree in their yard, and we certainly don't want to waste it. Instead, pick mangoes green. They are fabulous as a prebiotic fiber. Most Thai restaurants have a green mango or green papaya salad, and they're using it for the real reason it was created, to feed gut bacteria. Now, goji berries. I'm sorry, despite their health food reputation, goji berries are part of the nightshade family. They were the wolf berry of Americas, and they were taken to China in trade during Columbian trade, and they grew great in China. But do not be confused. They are a nightshade family. And so just avoid them. There's better substitutes. Golden berries, they're another nightshade. Now, yes, they do have some nutrients, but for most people, the risk really exceeds the benefit, especially if you have gut issues. Guava. Now, some of the smaller varieties are rich in polyphenols, but most guava and guava nectar is loaded with sugar. It's not worth it unless you really know the source or have one growing in your backyard. Now, did you ever wonder why fruit tastes so good? Well, you can actually thank a genetic mutation and evolution. Now, great apes, about 10 million years ago, suffered a genetic mutation, and they stopped making an enzyme called uricase that broke down a product of fructose metabolism called uric acid. Uric acid and triglycerides, both are products of fructose metabolism. Please understand, fructose is a mitochondrial toxin. I'm sorry, it is. Fructose is so dangerous that rather than being absorbed directly into our bloodstream, like glucose, fructose, most of fructose, is taken directly to the liver. Do not pass go, do not collect $200, where it's detoxified into triglycerides, a fat, and uric acid. Why would that be so interesting? Well, it turns out that great apes who suffered this mutation during a time of climate change, when forests were receding, great apes could take the fructose in ripe fruit and convert it into fat, number one, triglycerides, and number two, produce uric acid that produced insulin resistance. And if you listen to me enough, we know that insulin resistance increases the storage of fat, prevents fat breakdown, and is one of the biggest drivers of our dismal outcome right now. So what? So great apes could outcompete other monkeys to store fat for the lean times, whereas other monkeys couldn't. That made them the great apes. And they actually populated much of the world because they could travel on their fat. We, when we diverged from great apes about 6 to 8 million years ago, share that mutation. Now, for years, it was called the thrifty gene because we thought that somehow presto change-o, because we went long time without food, and we could walk long distances without food, and we were deprived of food, that we developed presto change-o, this magical thrifty gene. It's only been in recent years that we now realize that that thrifty gene is in fact the genetic mutation that allowed great apes to store fat from fruit and allows us to store fat from fructose. So what was of huge benefit to great apes and early humans, being able to eat fruit in season, take advantage of that fructose and convert it into fat and keep it stored as fat because of uric acid levels, became a major disadvantage to most of us now, because we now have 365 days of endless summer. And that mutation allows us now to constantly store fructose from fruit or from high fructose corn syrup as fat. And what was once what made us and great apes great has become one of our major limiting factors. Okay, now, what kind of fruit were these apes eating? What kind of fruit did modern humans eat before all this? It was wild. It was small. It was very fibrous. And most importantly, it was seasonal. Fruit does not ripen in the jungle year round. That's not how it happens. It is a seasonal thing. Just because we can grow strawberries down the road in Oxnard, California in January because of hybridization doesn't make that an in-season fruit. And just because a 747 can bring blueberries to Costco in February from Chile or Argentina doesn't make that a seasonal fruit. So it's this access to continuous fructose that's one of the big drivers of our insulin resistance, of our fat.
More amazing episodes just like this one. Watch now.
Where do you find these polyphenols in high concentrations? Now, you can find them in fruit.